So what was the idea around the flagship device or the platform that you're developing at Kitea, and the kind of the need that we have there?
Yeah, so really, it importantly has always started with the clinical need. And the way I explain it very, very quickly is that for most of us, we have friends, whānau at home that have chronic health conditions, lifelong conditions. You know, they might be a child with a neurological condition. They might be an elderly person in heart failure. And what we see currently is that the pathway for monitoring and managing those people, their health, is a very reactive care. You wait until Aunt Ethel is deteriorating with symptoms of a congestion and fluid retention in the lungs, and eventually it gets to a point where those symptoms say, okay, we better take you to hospital. You know, so you go to, then you go to hospital, then you get treatment modification, and then you come home. And whether it be a child with, say, in our case, one of our key clinical conditions, hydrocephalus, that's a recurring sort of nightmare for parents as they are frequent flyers to our healthcare system. And it was realizing that the problem is that we're very much stuck in a reactive care model. And if we can monitor people in their own homes, truly monitor, physiologically monitor, we can get early indications of deterioration, of changes in before symptoms occur. So rather than wait until you have got the screaming headache where pressure in your brain is going up, if we could monitor that early on and say, no, you're all good. It could just be food poisoning. It could just be a bad night for your child who may not be verbal at that point. So we can do proactive care, and therefore, and if you do proactive care, you can treat people early, you can catch symptoms, catch things before they become symptomatic and bring them into hospital, get treatment early, or you can weed out the false alarms. You know, for someone who has a chronic condition, they're often thinking, oh, we've got this headache, is that truly a headache or is that something more sinister? And so that's the gestation, that's the journey we're on to change that paradigm. And we do that through pressure monitoring. So my area of interest for many, many years has always been around how, what does pressure mean? What does it mean within the body? And not just blood pressure, heart and the pulmonary and the lungs and the cardiovascular system and in other areas of the body as well. It makes such a, it's so critical in the eye, for example, in the kidney and all of these things. Pressure is important, probably the most important in the brain, in terms of too much pressure, even a few millimeters mercury increase can have an impact on perfusion through key areas of the brain. So
Because when we think of pressure, it's just, oh, you go to the doctor and they wrap that little strap around your arm and they wait 5 seconds and go, oh, yeah, that's fine.
Within a
certain range. But that's just that systemic blood pressure. Whereas you're referring to like individual organs or individual tissues.
So, you know, pressure drives perfusion and for extruding out oxygen, good stuff, glucose, and then picking up waste products with lower pressure. And when you get to areas like the brain or in different parts of the cardiovascular system, not the arterial system, you can't measure that any other way than actually getting in there. Now, if it's an very acute, a couple of minutes to hours or maybe a couple of days, you can, in the case of hydrocephalus, drill a hole in someone's skull and put in a catheter and make that measurement. And obviously that's a hospital setting. You are sitting in bed with this thing coming out of your head. And there's a monitor there and they'll be saying, oh, well, yeah, that's good. No, that's not good. That sort of thing. So you can't do that any other way than, and people have tried non-invasive tools, but there's nothing validated. You have to measure directly, so which is what we're proposing is a means to proactively monitor in our first clinical condition, hydrocephalus, those patients to be monitored at home. So directly measuring pressure in the brain. And what, so what's actually happening is these people have the shunt that's draining away this excess fluid. Fantastic, keeps them alive, otherwise they die. But the shunts fail, worst failure rate of any medical device. 50% in 2 years will fail for children. So you've got a situation that your young child is at home and doing well, and then they're a bit irritable or they start vomiting. It happens all the time with little kids. And, you know, so parents are attuned to this and they're off to hospital. And, you know, we were reviewing cases yesterday and, you know, some of these kids are every couple of months they're in hospital for a stay, for observations, an MRI, and then they're sent home. So it's a not it's determined it's not the shunt. It's food poisoning, a headache, something else. So it's very hard for neurosurgeons, neurologists, and parents to know when the shunt's failing because we rely solely on symptoms currently. So our technology is all around actually providing accurate and their data, which then can be actionable. So no, the shunt is definitely failing. We will operate tomorrow or now.
Or replace it.
Replace it and you'll be good to go. Or no, I don't think it's the shunt. It is something else. Infection, food poisoning, headache, just non-specific headache, but it doesn't require the shunt to be replaced. So if you can do that, you can avoid some of that tragedy of going to the hospital for not when you don't need to. So that will lower costs and reduce anxiety and you know, well-being
and the health economic application as well must
absolutely
be pretty strong if you can avoid inpatient
stays. we think well, the estimate we have is that we can lower healthcare costs for these patients by 30 to 40%, so through our technology.
So taking a step back, if you have too much pressure in the brain, so is that, how does that, first of all, how does that arise? And then what are the kind of physiological manifestations of that? Is it, so there's buildup of fluid, and then that creates pressure and...
So in the spaces in the brain, the ventricles, fluid filled with cerebrospinal fluid. We produce roughly half a litre a day. The spaces aren't that big between our and the cavities in our brain, and that's absorbed. So it's produced and reabsorbed in a pretty constant rate. And it's either the defect is in too much production of fluid or not enough excretion of that fluid. Now, it can be a congenital disease. You know, spina bifida almost always has hydrocephalus. It can be due to trauma. So there can be a bleed on the brain. So that can occur at any age. It can be a trauma through an accident, you know, car accident sort of thing. So there are a range of different examples for the cause of it. But it's most common in children. And effectively, this fluid, if you have too much fluid, brain, skull being solid,
closed.
It's closed. So you've got too, so your blood pressure is the inflow as driving blood, and then you it's being opposed by the intracranial pressure, and what you the result is cerebral perfusion pressure, and that's actually the key number. We don't measure that directly. We measure it by intracranial pressure and blood pressure, and one minus the other. So if intracranial pressure goes up, you cannot perfuse the tissues as well, and when you don't perfuse tissues well, they don't get enough oxygen, and etc. etc. So that's why people with severe cases will, you know, they become unconscious very quickly and it's really life-threatening.
Right. And then you get like what, tissue hypoxia or
exactly.
And then
yeah,
tissue
you can
death and,
you can have permanent damage if it's not treated early enough.